Hare Krishna, and now I would like to hand over the call to Her Grace Preeti Vilasini Mataji. Mataji, you can take over the call.
Hare Krishna Mataji, are you there?
Hare Krishna, Dandavats, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you all so much for joining the call. My Dandavats to everyone on the call. Sorry, I was on mute. So today we are going to continue the seminar on Golok Achart. And
your volume is very low.
Is it? Has it improved or is it the same?
It's the same, Mataji. Can you be a little loud?
Okay, let me try. I can. Okay. Sorry. I'll try to log in from my phone.
Welcome. This service is provided by.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Mati, there's a very strong echo.
Okay, now is it better?
No, still same problem.
Okay, it should be better now?
Yes, yes, much, much better.
Okay, thank you. Okay, please forgive me for the delay. We'll be doing the Golok Achart seminar. This is going to be part 3. And in today's session, we will be covering the Brahma Jyoti and the Viraja River from where creation begins with Mahavishnu. So we will be getting into some details about creation, about how exactly creation is started by Mahavishnu. So we will cover whatever is happening in the Brahma Jyoti as well as in the Viraja River. So I don't think we'll have time to get into the universes, but we'll just see how the universes are created. So I'll start off with the prayers. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Ajnana Tilirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Nilutamena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Tirindyat Kripata Maham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nithanamne. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharini Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pachyati Deshatarini. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So in our previous 2 sessions, we have seen the Goloka Dham, which is the pink lotus. For those who are watching online, you can see the presenter by clicking on the link. And others can probably see the chart that you have at home or on your computer. So we will be referring to the chart just like the previous 2 times while I'm talking. I've also shared my screen for your reference in case you want to follow the PowerPoint. So now we have... in the previous 2 sessions, we have seen the Goloka section, that is the pink lotus, and we have also seen the blue lotus, which is the Vaikuntha section. So now what we'll do is we'll move further downward so that we can see the Brahma Jyoti and the Viraja River today. And from there, we will see how this entire material universe, that is this I know the circular shell that has been shown here is created. Now, all around the spiritual planets, that is the Goloka Vrindavan and the different Vaikuntha planets that we see here, Ayodhya Dham, around all of this, there is a strong effulgence that emanates, and that effulgence is called as the Brahma Jyoti. So you can see in the chart, it is all lit up. You can see the rays that is coming out from these different planetary systems. Originally, this is the effulgence of the bodily lustre of the Lord. But then it also transforms as the effulgence that comes out from the spiritual planets. So this whole effulgence is actually called as the Brahma Jyoti. So who is there in the Brahma Jyoti? What is this Brahma Jyoti all about? Why is it so effulgent? All the jivas who attained impersonal liberation occupy the Brahma Jyoti. So they attain the Brahma Jyoti. For example, the asuras that were killed by Krishna, we see that they attained the Brahma Jyoti. So like that, in many cases, you will see that one asura who's killed by Krishna, first he will enter the body of Krishna, and then after that, he appears in the Brahma Jyoti, attaining impersonal liberation. So like this, not only the asuras, but there are several jivas who had the desire to merge into the effulgence of their Lord. They all occupy positions in the Brahma Jyoti. Now, what are these jivas doing there? What is their state? So their state is actually very, very difficult to understand. These jivas, they are conscious, but they have no material or spiritual body. They don't have any body, but still they are actually conscious. So they experience what is called as Brahmananda. Now, why is this Brahmananda and Ananda? Why is it termed as Ananda? Ananda is there because they do not have to, they do not have to undergo the stress of the material world. So they are liberated in the sense that they are liberated out of the material world. But yet, this Ananda is not complete because they have nothing to do. Okay, so it is a kind of an Ananda called as a Brahmananda. But it is not complete spiritual happiness. Why? Because they don't have anything to do. So Prabhupada, once while traveling in an airplane, he looked out at the clouds and the airplane and the blue sky, and he said, see here, there is no variety. It's just plain blue sky all the while. For some time, you can look out in the flight, you know, when you're traveling a long distance. For a while, you will look out and you will think, wow, this is very nice. But as the plane moves on and on and on, it is just like, you know, one straight plane view. There is nothing else there. Once you reach a certain height, you have nothing to do. It's all plain blue sky. So Prabhupada was saying, see, this is how the jivas and the Brahma Jyoti feel. It is very boring. They don't get anything other than this. So Prabhupada says, because of pure intelligence, people take up to devotional service. But there are some people, because of impure intelligence, they don't understand what exactly devotional service is. And after some time of boredom in the Brahma Jyoti, the soul comes back to the material world and they begin to engage in different kinds of activities like altruistic activities or philanthropic activities, social activities like that. Just because they were like so bored, they just got down and then they begin serving humanity. So without activity and variety, one gets really, really bored. Hence, the people in Brahma Jyoti eventually are known to fall down. Now, for devotees who are practicing Krishna consciousness or devotees of the Lord, Brahma Jyoti is worse than hell because there is absolutely no opportunity for devotional service, seeing the beautiful form of the Lord, serving the Lord, or there is no devotional association as well. There are no other devotees with whom you can associate. So this material world as such, you know, that we are in, was actually created for us to enjoy independently from Krishna. That's why we came to the material world, because we had this desire to enjoy independently. So we had this opportunity of so many forms of life, you know. We have been through so many forms of life, and now we have taken this human birth of life. But in all these forms of life, there's absolutely no pleasure. No one is eternally happy. There's always distress and happiness. So no one feels eternal pleasure. And to solve this problem, the Mayavadi theory, they say get relieved from this place and go to the zone of Brahmananda, where there is only bliss. You don't have to deal with material nature. So, but there also, there is nothing. Oh, eventually, you know, they figure out that there is nothing. Again and again, there is nothing to do, and they fall down. So, this concept of Brahman merging is the worst for the devotees, because to become like, to become the Lord, you know, according to some Vayava theories, it's like you, they want to become the Lord. So this concept is the worst that devotees can think of, and it is the worst kind of offense that you can do to the Lord. So this is the position of the devotees merging into Brahma Jyoti. Now, in Srimad Bhagavatam purport, Prabhupada says, in a corner of the spiritual sky, now you should look at the spiritual sky, you can focus on Vaikuntha, that is the blue lotus. And there you see in the northeast corner, remember in the previous session we were talking about Ishana, you can see the focus here. This is the place where actually the material creation emanates. This is where you will see Viraja Mahavishnu, and then you will see the material world emanating from there. Actually, that is how technically it is according to scripture. But however, since this is a Goloka chart, they have put the material world below the spiritual world, because we should not get the understanding that since the material world is coming out from the northeast corner, it is above the spiritual world. So technically, material world is nowhere in any way better than the spiritual world. Hence, in the chat, they have put the entire region of this Viraja River and the creation of material universes below in the chart. But how exactly material creation begins is actually from the northeast corner. You see here, Ishana, I've also given a slide for that. So the northeast corner, you can see Ishana here. This is the focus of Ishana. From here, you can see this bright white light, this area. From here, actually, the entire material creation process happens. Okay, keeping that in mind, let's continue to see what's written in Srila Prabhupada's purport. Prabhupada says in Bhagavatam, in a corner of the spiritual sky, which we understand as northeast from the direction of Ishana, of the Brahma Jyoti, so you will see Brahma Jyoti here in this corner. In this, Brahma Jyoti is engulfing everywhere, but now we have to visualize only that part. Okay, from there, a spiritual cloud sometimes appears, and the covered portion is called as Mahatattva. The Lord then, by his plenary portion as Mahavishnu, lies down within the water of the Mahatattva, and the water is called as Karana Ocean or Karana Jal. This is Srimad Bhagavatam 2533 purport. So that's why you will see the way it is shown in the chart, is that here you will see a spiritual cloud. They have just shown a cloud-like thing that is appearing. This is from where the Ishana actually begins. You can see the Viraja River here. This blue portion is the dark blue portion of the Viraja River. And we'll talk about the details of Sadashiva Loka a little later, Mahakalada. We'll cover that a little later. First, we will see what is happening in the Viraja River. Okay? So here, you see a cloud-like thing that is coming. And then you have the causal ocean, also called as the Karana Ocean, also called as the Viraja River, where we have Mahavishnu, who is also known as Karanodgashayi Vishnu. He is lying down. Okay, why is he lying down there? Because he wants to start the creation. Okay? Now, who is this Karanodgashayi Vishnu? So, in our previous sessions, when we saw the Vaikuntha Dham, we saw that there was the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha. So the original, the first Chaturvyuha was in the pink lotus, which is Goloka Dham. Then in the blue lotus, we had the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha. From the Shankarsan of the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha expands this particular form of Vishnu, who is known as Mahavishnu, or he is also known as Karanodakashayi Vishnu. Now, what is this Karana Ocean? According to some texts, Karana Ocean is created by the sweat of Mahavishnu, or rather Mahavishnu himself just creates it. But according to certain other texts like Padma Purana, this Karana Ocean is created by the sweat of the personified Vedas. We also saw the personified Vedas in our previous two sessions, how they occupy different positions in the spiritual world. That these are the prototype Vedas. So from their sweat, the Karana Jal is formed. So there are two references two understandings of the spiritual, of how the Karana Jal is formed. Now, what is the role of Mahavishnu? Why is he known as the creator of all the universes? So Lord Vishnu, what he is doing there is that he is in Yoga Nidra. You can see that he's actually lying down, you know. He's actually sleeping. But this is no mundane sleep, like as we sleep out of ignorance. But Lord Mahavishnu doesn't have any ignorance. Rather, he's in a mystic slumber. It's called as the transcendental mystic slumber. And there, lying down like that in a slumber, he's consorting with his consort, who is Rama Devi. He's having amorous pastime with his consort, who's known as Rama Devi. So here you can see Rama Devi is sitting down here in a pink lotus. You can see her, the figure of Rama Devi. So she is the consort of this Karanodakashayi Vishnu. Now both of them are going to have amorous pastimes. Just like how we see in the Goloka Dham, Radha Krishna are having amorous pastimes. That is the primary function that's happening there. They are just enjoying. So similarly in Vaikuntha, you will see Lakshmi Narayana just enjoying. Everyone is serving him while he's just enjoying. He has nothing much to do there. Even in Goloka, Krishna has nothing to do. He's just playing, he's just enjoying, pastimes with Radharani. Similarly, here in the Karana Ocean, Mahavishnu, his primary pastime is to enjoy with Rama Devi. The secondary, auxiliary pastime is actually creation. As a result of their enjoyment that they are having, we have creation. So all this creation is also a leela, because primarily it's just the enjoyment of Karanodakashayi Vishnu with his consort Rama Devi. Now, see, Rama Devi can be understood as the internal potency, Yoga Maya. So what is the function of Yoga Maya? What does she do? The function of Yoga Maya is different from the function of Mahamaya. Krishna has two energies, you know, Yoga Maya, Mahamaya. Now, internal potency or Yoga Maya, what does she do? She arranges pastimes for Krishna. She gives shelter to devotees. She helps the devotees to take shelter of the Lord. All that is the jurisdiction of Yoga Maya. Whereas the external energy or Mahamaya keeps us bound to the material world. So the energy who's in charge of creating this external world is actually Mahamaya. Right? Now this Maya, she covers the conditional living entities. But when the conditioned souls want to become devotees of the Lord or become devotees of the Lord, slowly she uncovers their eyes. So, in general, we understand that the Lord has nothing to do with material nature. Now, he is in the spiritual world, he is enjoying pastimes, and all the living entities in the material world are also lost because they have lost connection with the Lord and they are engaged in mundane activities. So they also generally do want to know Krishna. However, though Krishna has nothing to do with the people in the material world, still he tries to have some connection so that they can get back to him. He is very, very merciful. He doesn't have a connection, but still he wants to have a connection. So this is the principle of Achintya Bheda Bheda. We don't understand that. Krishna doesn't want to have a connection with the devotees in the material world, but still he wants to have a connection. In short, though Krishna doesn't have interest with his external energy, still he decides to deal with it just for our sake. So when he wants to relate with his external energy, he begins to have his amorous pastimes with his internal energy, Rama Devi. Just like how I was mentioning in the spiritual world, we see that Lakshmi Narayan or Radha Krishna engage in amorous pastimes. Similarly, here Mahavishnu decides to consort with Rama Devi. And who is this Rama Devi? She is an expansion of the goddess of fortune, who in turn is the expansion of Srimati Radharani. So when he wants to create, he begins his conjugal relationship. It is activated, and based on this relationship, the external energy, Mahamaya, begins to initiate. Okay? So we'll read one verse from Srimad Bhagavatam in this connection. Srimad Bhagavatam 3.5.24. It says, "The Lord, the undisputed proprietor of everything, was the only seer." So this is before the creation begins. So we are still concentrating on the Viraja area, right? So we are seeing what this Mahavishnu is doing here now. So it says, the Lord, the undisputed proprietor of everything, was the only seer. The cosmic manifestation was not present at that time. So, hence, the Lord, he felt imperfect without his plenary and separated parts and parcels. The material energy was dormant, whereas the internal potency was already manifested. So, the relationship between Rama and Mahavishnu had started. But here you see a picture of Durga Devi riding on a tiger or a lion. Yeah, it looks like a tiger. So she is riding on a tiger here. Now, this Durga Devi, she is currently dormant. Okay, this is the condition we are in now. So we are seeing Mahavishnu is glancing at Rama Devi. He is having amorous pastimes with Rama Devi. But Maya, the material energy, she is staying a little away and she is remaining dormant. Okay, so the Lord is the supreme seer. Only by his glance did the material energy become active for cosmic manifestation. At that time, the seer was there, but the external energy over which the glance of the Lord was cast was not present. So what happened at that time? He felt somewhat insufficient, just like how a husband feels lonely in the absence of his wife. So the Lord wanted to create the cosmic manifestation. He wanted to start creation. He wanted to give all these jivas another chance to go to the material world and understand that the material world is a temporary place and then come back home back to Godhead. So this was the main purpose. This was the desire of the Lord. The Lord is so kind that in the absence of such a manifestation, he feels something is lacking because he's not giving the chance to the conditioned souls. So he feels something wanting and hence the creation takes place. So why does the creation take place? It takes place because the Lord has a desire for creation to take place and also he wants to give a chance for the living entities to go to a place so that they can enjoy independently of Krishna and then come back. So although the internal potency was already manifested, the other potency, who's the other potency, the external potency or the material world, it appeared to be sleeping. So the Lord wanted to awaken her to activity, just like how her husband wants to wake up his wife so that he can have some conversation or enjoy with the wife. So the Lord, he wanted to awaken the external energy and the whole process of this creation was just to enliven all the keeping conditioned souls to the real life of spiritual consciousness so that they can eventually get liberated and go back to the spiritual world. Okay. Now, so far we have understood that the material energy was still in a sleeping state. So what happened at this time? And how? What do you mean by the cosmic manifestation was in a sleeping state? So, cosmic manifestation was in a sleeping state means this pradhan, it is called as the pradhan, this term for the sleeping state is called as a pradhan. It was in an unmanifested state. That means all the material ingredients were given by Mahavishnu, but they were all mixed up together. Like for example, earth, water, fire, mind, intelligence, false ego, senses. All these are actually the building blocks of the material universe. But all these building blocks were not manifested separately. It was all like, you know, mixed up together in an unmanifested state. So, you know, Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj, he gives this analogy that he says that you cannot distinguish them separately like river, mountain, land, like that. Everything was like a primordial soup. Okay, like how a soup has many vegetables and herbs. So when you really cook it up, it's all mashed together and you cannot distinguish cauliflower from celery to potato to carrot or tomato. Everything is mixed up together in a mushy soup. So like that is the state of pradhan. Everything was mixed up. It was in a raw state and one could not be distinguished from the other. So this was the condition of the material manifestation. Okay, she was in a dormant state. So at that time, what the Lord does is he glances at the pradhan, or rather he glances at Durga Devi And that is actually the first step of waking up the material energy. And in his glance, the time energy is past. Okay? So, what is actually there in the body of Mahavishnu? Who is sleeping there? All the devotees, all the jivas are in a suspended state. They are actually sleeping in the body of Mahavishnu. Okay? And Kala has also stopped there. When they are all lying down in the body of Mahavishnu, Kala has stopped, but all the jivas are sitting there in a suspended state. So when the Lord glances, there is something within this glance. That is really the first step of waking up material energy. So in his glance, the time energy is cast, and the time factor actually contacts the sleeping material nature. Even in casting his glance, the Lord actually has no contact with this deluding energy, because his chit potency, who is Rama Devi, she actually carries the function of his glance. So Rama, she does the service for Mahavishnu. She carries different things. There are so many things that is coming out from the glance of Mahavishnu. Here you can see in this picture, you can see Mahavishnu is actually casting his glance through Rama Devi. Actually, the glance is kind of bright as he's looking at Rama Devi. But from Rama Devi, the functions or the materials that is there in his glance is transported to Maya Devi. And we will see another character here called as Shambhu, who actually touches Maya. Okay, we will see that next. So first we are seeing that the glance of Mahavishnu is actually going through Rama Devi. Rama Devi is the carrier who is going to go and agitate Maya. So Maya serves Rama. She serves Mahavishnu. Rama serves Mahavishnu. Maya Devi is the servant of Rama Devi, and Rama Devi, she serves Mahavishnu. So that all the fallen souls can go back to Godhead. So in between the previous destruction and the new creation, all the jivas are within Mahavishnu. So when the previously, when the cosmic manifestation was destroyed or dismantled, at that time, the jivas who were there in the material world, they all went, and they went within the body of Mahavishnu. And what are they doing there? They were in a state called as sushupti, or deep sleep. So how could one sleep for so long? You know, between two cosmic manifestations, it takes a very long time. So how could one sleep for such a long time? It is because their karma had stopped. They were not receiving any reactions. Okay? Their karma was inert. You can't say it was stopped. It was rather paused, you can say. It was in a somewhat like a inert state. Because they were receiving karmic reactions in the material world, they were initiated from one activity to another. But because their karma is stopped in the body of Mahavishnu, they were not doing any action. They were all in a deep sleeping state called as Sushupti. How was their karma stopped? It was because time was stopped. Time was stopped in the body of Mahavishnu. Time is actually the driving factor of everything in the material world. So only under the influence of time, karmic activity can be received, right? So because of the influence of time, a living entity is actually gone from one situation to the other. Whatever we are doing is actually the influence of time. So it is the time force that is invigorating all the stock of karma that we have. But when the creation is wound up and time stops and goes inside Mahavishnu and remains in Mahavishnu, we also go there. We sleep inside the body of Mahavishnu there in a cocoon of our own karma, and our karma is actually stopped there. Okay? So hence we are in the deep state of Sushupti. But Rama Devi and Mahavishnu, both of them, they understand the desire of the Lord that he wants to create. I mean, Rama understands the desire of the Lord. Mahavishnu wants to give a chance to all the conditioned souls to go and, you know, perform our karma. And hence, they begin having their amorous pastimes. And Maya Devi, who's a servant of Rama Devi, she also understands, and hence she helps Rama Devi to help Mahavishnu execute their desire. So this is the whole process of creation. Now, there are two aspects to the glance of Mahavishnu. One aspect of his glance, he actually creates the pradhan. We were talking about the primordial soup, right? The pradhan, the materials Because glands, actually the materials come into existence, and this glands of Karnodakshay Vishnu, the glands itself is given a term called as Mahavishnu, according to Chaitanya Charitamrita. The glands itself has a term called as Mahavishnu, with which the pradhan or the accommodating chamber for the material world is created. There is another aspect to Mahavishnu's glands. That gland actually excites the material energy. So we saw that Mahavishnu's glands has to excite material energy. So that aspect is termed as Advaita Acharya and Chaitanya Charitamrita. So there are some verses that talk about the glands of Mahavishnu and Chaitanya Charitamrita. One aspect is called Mahavishnu and the other aspect is called as Advaita Acharya. So that's why we see here Advaita Acharya is actually Mahavishnu himself, right, when he came and performed pastimes with Lord Chaitanya. So these are the two aspects of the glands. So this gland we saw first touches Ramadevi, and from Ramadevi what happens is that glands, it develops a dim halo, okay, a dim halo, and this halo is nothing but Shambhu or Shivalingam that actually impregnates the yoni, which is Durga Devi. So you will see that Karnodakshay Vishnu is not directly touching Maya Devi. Rather, it is Shambhu. This gland develops a dim halo who is known as Shambhu. And you can see Shambhu here holding a trident, riding on the bull. And he is the one who touches his consort, who is Maya Devi. So Karnodakshay Vishnu transforms. Here the transformation begins into Shambhu. Okay, now this Shambhu is Shiva Tattva. He is not pure Vishnu Tattva. So we saw about Sadashiva earlier. We will be seeing about him again. But that Sadashiva we saw was actually Vishnu Tattva. We discussed that earlier. But now we see that this Shambhu who is coming from the glands of Mahavishnu becomes a transformative product. He is a transformation. He is no more pure Vishnu Tattva. Hence, he takes on the position of Shiva Tattva, and the first Shiva Tattva here is called as Shambhu, and he touches Maya Devi. And then the material universe actually is created. That's why we say, Mata Cha Parvati Devi Pita Devo Maheshwaraha. How is it? It is because our mother, universe, the mother of this material universe is Durga Devi, and her consort is Shambhu, who is Shiva. Okay, so with the union of the Shiva Linga with the Yoni, who is Durga Devi, actually material universe begins. Okay, so Shambhu is the father and Durga is the mother. So this Shambhu is the father and the Adhara Shakti or accommodating chamber is actually Maya Devi. So this Maya Devi, she is the womb where material nature begins to manifest. So she also, just like how in a mother's womb the child is born, similarly, and also the mother gives all the nourishment to the child, similarly, this Maya Devi, she also provides all the ingredients for the material nature. Just like how the womb is the accommodating chamber for an embryo. So the two combine, and by, how do they combine? They combine only by the will of Karnodakshay Vishnu, because Karnodakshay Vishnu desired. Because of his original glands, Shambhu and Maya, they combine and then material world is created. Okay? Now, a little bit about the Shambhu. So, this Shambhu, he has a degree of deluding quality of Maya because he's in direct touch with her. Because he's in direct contact with her, he acquires this degree of deluding quality. So, sometimes he's also known as Tamasi. So these jivas that we see in the material world, they are all limited. So Shambhu has a contact with Maya. He also has a contact with the jivas in the material world. And hence, there is some amount of a limited nature that is seen in Shambhu. Whereas the Supreme Lord, Vishnu Tattva, is always the Lord of full potency because he doesn't directly touch the material universe. Now, Durga, she has a small amount of knowledge and bliss of Ramadevi. But still, she is not completely Ramadevi. She is transformed. Shambhu is transformed. Durga or Maya is also a transformed energy. Now, Shambhu is a transformed portion of Vishnu and his personal energy, Shambhu's personal energy, is Maya Devi or his consort. So, I hope this region, these characters are kind of clear for you now. Now, as mentioned previously, the Lord doesn't contact his mundane material energy directly, and it is only Shambhu who touches Maya, and this is the first prototype of reproductive act. So, the contact between Shambhu and Maya is the prototype reproductive act. It is the Shivalinga, and that is the male principle of creation. Okay. Now, Maya Devi, the yoni or the womb of material nature, is actually the female principle. So, the humans, demigods, plants, animals, all of them you see in this material world, they all embody the male and the female principle. That is how reproduction happens, right? The male and the female principle. But the prototype of all these principles is actually seen in Shambhu and Maya. So, now we'll see who are the four people who are here. Mahavishnu, we'll give some, I have given this earlier for us to understand better. Mahavishnu is like the, just imagine how electricity comes to our house. You know, just for us to understand how this, how these four personalities are functioning, let's see how electricity comes to our house. So we have Mahavishnu, who's like the electric powerhouse. From there, the electricity is distributed. Rama Devi is actually the electrical energy, because she's dealing with potency, right? She's the potency of the Lord. What is potency? It is the electric power. So if Mahavishnu is like the electric powerhouse, Rama Devi is the electrical energy. And Shambhu is actually the copper wire through which electricity runs through in our house. And what does the copper wire touch? It actually touches the bulb, right? Which is the electrified object, who is Maya Devi. So we have Mahavishnu, who is like the electric powerhouse, Rama Devi, who is like the electrical energy, Shambhu, who is like the wire through which the electricity runs through, and Maya is actually the electrified object. So this is how we understand creation with electricity. So, but ultimately, we should always bear in mind that Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Aham Bijam Pradapita. He is the original seed-giving father. It is only from Krishna. These are all different agents that we just saw. So it should be understood that all species of life, O Kunti, are made possible by birth in this material nature, and I am the seed-giving father. This is the verdict of Krishna. So, from Mahavishnu, from the pores of his body, what happens as he exhales? So we just saw what is coming out from the glands of Mahavishnu. So, what happens as Mahavishnu exhales? Mahavishnu is lying there and he exhales. And when he exhales, from the millions of the pores of the body of Mahavishnu, millions of universes are emanating as he exhales. And from his glands that touches Rama and later carried by Shambhu and that touches Maya, the jivas are impregnated into the material nature. From his glands, the jivas are coming out and they are getting impregnated in material nature. From the bodily pores, millions and millions of universes are emanating from the body of Mahavishnu as he exhales. When Mahavishnu inhales, what happens? Everything is withdrawn into him. Again, jivas go and sleep in Shushupti. Okay? So, it's for Mahavishnu, just think about it. It's not that Mahavishnu has such a long breath that when he exhales, creation begins, and when he inhales, everything goes in. No, for him, it is actually just one breath. Like how for us, just what is one breath? Like a split second for us? So similarly, for Mahavishnu, for his condition and his size, it is just one breath. But for us, it is such a long time because we are so minuscule when compared to the Lord who's creating everything. Okay? So when he exhales, millions of universes, they are emanating from the bodily pores and they all float in the Virija River as he is exhaling. That is where you see all these golden eggs that are coming out. You can see it in the picture where from the bodily pores of Mahavishnu, from his exhaling, all these golden eggs are coming out and they are all floating in the Virija River. This entire thing is Virija River or the Karana Ocean, and all these golden eggs are coming out from there. So that's why in the pastime of Vamana Dev, when Vamanadeva peers through the coverings of the material universe, we see that actually it was Viraja that was transformed into Ganga, and that is what was seeped in. It was the waters of the Viraja that actually entered when Vamanadeva actually pierced the coverings of the material universe. Similarly, when Krishna and Arjuna, they went in search of the Brahmana's son in Dwaraka, there is this pastime where Krishna and Arjuna, they cross all the coverings of the material universe because Mahavishnu or Karnodakshaya Vishnu actually had taken off the sons of the Brahmana. So at that time when they go and they cross the material covering, you will see that first they suddenly see Brahma Jyoti, then they come to the residence of Mahavishnu. Here we are seeing the residence of Mahavishnu, you have put Mahavishnu somewhere in the Viraja River. But when these, in the story of Arjuna and Krishna going in search of the sons of the Brahmana, first they will see a bright light, which is actually Brahma Jyoti. Then they will go to the residence of Mahavishnu. How is it possible? That is also described by Prabhupada. Prabhupada says that these universes, they are actually floating on Viraja. Some are half submerged, some are a little, fully submerged, some are just floating like a ball, like that. And they appear like cluster of grapes. You will see some are slightly above, some are slightly less. Just like imagine a cluster of grapes, how you can imagine there are some grapes that are on top, some grapes a little down. Like that, these material universes, some universes are floating like a ball, some universes are half submerged, some universes are fully submerged, like that. So that is how these universes that are coming out from the body of Mahavishnu are actually lying in Viraja River. So in our particular, the pastime that we see in Bhagavatam, what happens is when in our universe, when Arjuna and Krishna, they go out of the material coverings of the universe, they first see Brahma Jyoti, and then they enter into the Karana ocean. And then they go and visit the Karanodakshaya Vishnu. So that is also plausible. You know, because different universes are in different conditions floating on the floating on the Viraja River from the coming out from the body of Mahavishnu. So these are some details, because sometimes you might see some verses that say, oh, Viraja came after Brahma Jyoti. Then how do you understand? So all these are explained by Acharya. Now, other than Mahavishnu, there are some missing characters here. We are seeing only four characters here in this area, but there are actually many missing characters. Who are these missing characters? Around Mahavishnu, actually many prototype demigods are also seen. Okay. Now, these prototype demigods are described in Brahma Samhita. In the Brahma Samhita, you will find that actually there is a prototype Brahma, there is a prototype Shiva, who is actually Shambhu, whom we already saw, who is coming out from the glands. We already saw that. And then there is from Mahavishnu, or this Karanodakshaya Vishnu, there is also Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who is created. So there are some verses in Brahma Samhita that talk about this. It says, I think this is verse 15 of Brahma Samhita, 5.15. Shambhu's manifestation is made more clear in this verse. It says that he comes from the space between the eyebrows of Mahavishnu. That means he appears from the eyebrows, and from his glance, his function begins. Shambhu's functions begin. But from the left limb of this Karanodakshaya Vishnu, from the left limb of Karanodakshaya Vishnu, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is created, and from the right limb, Brahma, whose Prajapati, is created. But bear in mind, these are the prototypes. Which Brahma is this? He's called as Hiranyagarbha Brahma, or he's the prototype of all Brahmas. This Hiranyagarbha Brahma is actually the seminal principle for all other Brahmas appearing in different universes. So just like how we have individual Brahmas and individual Garbhodakshaya Vishnus in each and every universe, there is one prototype who is residing there, from whom all the other Brahmas are created, or all the other respective demigods are created in each universe. So in this region, in the picture, it is missing, as this was also confirmed by Prabhuji, that these paths are missing in the picture, that there are prototype demigods also. You can actually put pictures of all the prototype demigods, including Brahma and Indra, Chandra, everyone. everybody is there surrounding Mahavishnu, and from the middle of his forehead, Shambhu is coming out. From the left limb, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is coming out. From the right limb, Brahma is coming out. So all of them are coming out, and all of them are prototypes. And from there, individual universes get their demigods from this prototype. Okay? Now, again, this prototype Brahma has nothing to do with the four-headed Brahma of our universe, or it has nothing to do with the ten-headed Brahma of the other universes. Or this is actually the prototype, and from them, all the other Brahmas are created. So from the left limb, I made a mistake. I said Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is created from the left limb. Please forgive me. It is actually Kshirodakshayi Vishnu who is created from the left limb. Left limb Kshirodakshayi Vishnu is created. Okay. Yeah, left limb is Kshirodakshayi Vishnu. And from him, the other Kshirodakshayi Vishnus are actually created in the universe. So I made a mistake. It was not Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. It is Kshirodakshayi Vishnu who is created from the left limb. Okay. Now, few more details that is there. So this original, the prototype Brahma and the prototype Shambhu, they actually create the other demigods that is seen in the other universe. And that is why in Bhagavatam, there is one place where Srimad Bhagavatam describes that there are prototype demigods like sun, Indra, air god, fire god, everyone who go and pray to Vishnu to begin creation. There is one verse in Srimad Bhagavatam. So one may ask, how did all these demigods appear even before creation? The answer is there are also prototypes from whom the individual universes get their demigods. Okay? Now, so after the universes are created by Mahavishnu, these universes, they get enveloped by subtle layers, and then what happens? So now we see here in this picture, there are golden eggs that are coming out from the body of Mahavishnu. Now this golden egg then gets enveloped into different layers. Okay, so here you can see the different layers in each universe. You can see there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 layers. Mahatattva, false ego, ether, air, fire, water, earth. So basically this shell, each and every Brahmanda gets enveloped with different layers once they come out. And what happens inside each and every shell? This Karanodakshayi Vishnu, he himself expands as Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. I made a mistake when I was saying it is actually from the left limb, the Kshirodakshayi Vishnu, original Kshirodakshayi Vishnu actually expands from there. But Karanodakshayi Vishnu himself or Mahavishnu himself, he comes down, he expands himself as Garbhodakshayi Vishnu into several seven universes. Okay? So he comes down and he fills less than half of the universe. You can see in this picture that there is an ocean on which he is lying. Garbhodakshayi Vishnu is lying on an ocean. So you can see that it is almost half of the universe. It's not really half, it is slightly less than half of the universe. So what this Garbhodakshayi Vishnu does is he fills up less than half of the universe with a sweat, which is actually called as the Garbhodak Ocean. So this Garbhodakshayi Vishnu is sleeping on the Garbhodak Ocean. And the Ramadevi, we saw Ramadevi was consulting with Karanodakshayi Vishnu, right? She expands into another Lakshmi form who serves this Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. You can see that she is massaging his feet. And again, he is lying down on Ananta. And from his navel, the 14 universes are created, and the demigod Brahma appeared. So this demigod Brahma is not the prototype Brahma we said who appears from the right limb of Mahavishnu. That prototype is providing different Brahmas in different universes, or rather they are expansions of that prototype. Okay. So from his navel, the universal creation begins. And within each and every universe, there is also a Kshirodakshayi Vishnu who occupies. And he takes up his residence in the ocean of milk. You can see where it is located. It's near Dhruvaloka. You can see the location here. So here is the Kshirodaka ocean, or the ocean of milk. Okay. Here, another expansion of Vishnu, who's known as Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, goes and resides in every universe. Every universe has a Kshirodakashayi Vishnu as well. Now, this Kshirodakashayi Vishnu is actually the Paramatma within every living entity's heart, and he also occupies his residence in each and every atom. Other than that, he's also located in the Kshira ocean, okay, in this region, as you see in the chart. This is Kshirodakashayi Vishnu. Now, within the universe, when there is a crisis, all the demigods who are jiva tattvas, okay, within the universe, when there is a crisis, they go to the shores of the Kshirodakashayi Vishnu's ocean, and there they stand and they offer prayers. They don't directly see Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, but they offer prayers, and then they converse with Kshirodakashayi Vishnu from the shores of these oceans. Okay. So within the universe, all this happens. When we see that demigods go and offer their prayers to Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, the milk ocean, means they are going here. They are not going to the Kshirodakashayi ocean. Okay. So there are three Vishnus. We know Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, Garbhodakashayi Vishnu, who's lying down here inside the universe, and Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, who's present there at the as a functional Paramatma for all living entities. Now, another point is that Kshirodakashayi Vishnu alone is not the Paramatma. How is that? Because Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, or Mahavishnu, is the Paramatma for the entire creation, because the entire creation is coming out from his bodily pores. So he is considered as the Paramatma for all the material universes. All the material universes put together, who is the Paramatma? Kshirodakashayi Vishnu. For each and every universe, who is the Paramatma? It is Garbhodakashayi Vishnu. Because only from the navel of Garbhodakashayi Vishnu, the universes within this shell, or within this Brahmanda, is actually manifested. So he becomes the super soul for all the universes within a Brahmanda. And this Kshirodakashayi Vishnu, who is located here, he becomes the Paramatma for every living entity and for every atom. So there are Paramatmas in three different levels. There are Vishnus in three different levels. Okay. So this is about the Vishnu and where each Vishnu resides. Now, as I mentioned, everything, this entire universal creation, everything that happens is just one breath of this Mahavishnu, who was lying down in the Viraja ocean. Now, I wanted to say a few words, as I mentioned earlier, about Sadashiva Loka. So we saw that the northeast corner of the spiritual world, from there the Ishana emanates, and from there Lord Sadashiva comes. Now, Sadashiva, the same loka is actually projected here. The same thing is actually projected here in the center, just above Shambhu. You can see the Sadashiva loka is projected. This is actually nothing but the northeast corner. So the upper portion of this loka of Mahesh Dham, if you see on the left hand side, it will be written Mahesh Dham. So on the upper side, it is called as the Sadashiva loka, and it is spiritual. Okay, it is well lit, it is spiritual, and there Lord Sadashiva resides. The lower portion is called as Mahakala Dham. Okay, so this Mahakala Dham is a very important place, and this actually is from where Shambhu carries his trident and time energy manifests. We saw that the ingredients needed for the time is coming from the glands of Mahavishnu. We saw that already. But everything is being transported slowly, and then this glands forms a dim halo. We saw that, right? So that dim halo is nothing but Shambhu. What is Shambhu doing? He's holding a trident, and he begins the kala, the time energy. So from here, time begins. With his trident, which has three spokes, it is present, past, and future. So present, past, and future, meaning time energy, actually begins from this place of Mahakala Dham. This place is described to be very, very dark. That's why it is painted also in a very intense dark blue, or rather blackish. It is described as being dark. And from there, the presiding deity, Shambhu, carries his trident and he touches Maya. So these are the two portions of Shivaloka. There are two portions. One is the Sadashivaloka, the lower part is called as Mahakala Dhamma. Okay? And I just want to check if I've missed anything regarding the... Yeah, that's it. So this is something you want to keep in mind about Mahakala Dham and the Sadashiva Loka. So there is one verse that is quoted about Mahesh Dham, the abode of Lord Shiva, on the chart. Verse 30, it says Brahma Samhita 543 purport. Next above Devi Dham is located Shiva Dhamma, one portion of which is called Mahakala Dham. It is enveloped in darkness. Interpenetrating this portion of Shiva Dham, there shines the Sadashiva Loka full of great light. Above the same appears Haridham, the transcendental Vaikuntha Loka. So we saw the different regions. We saw Sadashiva, Mahakala, we see Brahmajyoti, and on top of that you will see Vaikuntha. Below Mahakala Dham, around this area is the Viraja, and below Viraja is the material universe. So the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha, actually, that we saw the Shankarsana of the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha from the Vaikuntha. From him, actually, both this Mahavishnu, who is Karanodakashaya Vishnu, and the Sadashiva here, the bright portion, both of them are expanding from the Dvitiya Chaturvyuha. Okay? So, in some places, you will see, even in Bhagavatam, sometimes Sadashiva is not differentiated from Karanodakashaya Vishnu. It can be quite confusing. Why? Because this second Shankarsana from the second Chaturvyuha, he actually expands into two forms. One is called a Sadashiva, the other one is Karanodakashaya Vishnu. He actually expands into both. Okay? And now, the lower half of the Sadashiva Loka, which is called as Mahakala Dham, is dark in color, and here actually Shambhu is created. Now, this Shambhu becomes Shiva Tattva. Above Sadashiva Loka, it was Vishnu Tattva. Below, it becomes Shiva Tattva. Why? Because Shambhu holds his trident. He activates time and he touches Maya. So from here, Shiva Tattva begins. So originally, this Shambhu is actually an expansion of the Sadashiva. Who is the Sadashiva? He is Vishnu Tattva. And he is an expansion of the second Chaturvyuha of Shankarsana. Okay? So this is how the Shiva Tattva actually begins. Now this Shambhu, this separate Shiva Tattva, from him only the other Shivas in the material universe begin to appear. So the material universe's Shiva are not actually Vishnu Tattva. And again, this is also described in, I don't know if it's too much details, but sometimes Shiva Tattva can, some of the Shivas in the material universe can be Shiva Tattva, sometimes he can even be Jiva. So there are a lot of expansions and further expansions of Lord Shiva. Shiva Tattva is very complicated, so we will not get into that. But this is how the Shiva Tattva begins. This is the differentiation between Shambhu and Sadashiva. And even the Loka, you can see, is actually separated. You have Mahakala Dham and you have Sadashiva Loka. So this is what I wanted to cover today. This is how inner material world begins. And there are some more explanations. Of course, Brahma Samhita talks about the difference between Shiva and Vishnu Tattva. Vishnu Tattva is like milk and Shiva Tattva is like yogurt. Just like how milk comes in contact with some acidic substance, it transforms into yogurt. Similarly, this Sadashiva or this Karanodakashaya Vishnu, actually, when he comes in contact, he transforms himself as Shambhu because he's in touch with material energy. So it's a transformative product, hence the tattva changes. So just like how you've seen in those days those old lantern lamps. So there'll be a small wick with fire, which is the lamp, and around that you will see a glass dome. So over a period of time, what happens is that the soot, it gets deposited over the glass, and the clarity of the lamp shining actually reduces over a period of time. The lamp becomes duller and duller. So this is another example that is given by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur for us to understand how Vishnu Tattva is different from Shiva Tattva. So Shiva Tattva is actually like the dim halo. Or the Shambhu is like the dim halo that comes eventually after a lot of soot that is deposited. So the soot is actually like the material energy that is covering him. But before the soot is deposited, originally he was like the glance, the original glance of Mahavishnu was different. Later, the original glance became dim, like the lamp that is covered by soot as he touched Mayadevi. So this is the complete understanding of how material universes are created. Then our next session, we have finished Viraja and we have finished Brahmajyoti. So in our next session, we will see, and we also saw how the three Vishnus have manifested, how every universe got its own Garbhodakshayi Vishnu and its own Shirodakshayi Vishnu. Now we will see how the demigods manifest, how this Brahma came about, the Brahma on the lotus, how he comes about, what are these 14 lokas, then what are the lower planetary system, what is Naraka Loka, what is Pitru Loka, all that we will see in our next session. And we have to also do the coverings, the Mahatattva, false ego. We didn't get into the details. Either air, fire, water. We didn't get into the details of all these. We will get into those details also in the next session. So, yeah, perfect. It's 1 hour. So if you have any questions or comments, please go ahead. And any corrections, please tell me. I would have made mistakes. So thank you so much for your patience listening. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji, Dhamrat Pranam, wonderful class, wonderful, wonderful in-depth explanation. Mataji, I know you repeated this several times, but I still didn't catch it. What is the real difference between Sadashiva and Shambhu? You said Sadashiva is Vishnu Tattva. And yes, but at what point does he come and what is his function? Maybe I missed that. Because I know, okay, Shambhu is creation, you said. So if I'm visualizing, like, let's say Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh, so Mahesh is that Shambhu, right? No?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
But he's destruction, right? But he's creation.
Yeah, that's why he's called Mahakala, because he comes from Mahakala Dham, because Mahakala actually destroys. He's the time personified. He comes and he destroys. Yeah.
So he's destroying, not creating. Yeah. No, he's creating also, right? Does he?
Yeah, he does. The thing is, Vishnu also does all the three, Shambhu also does all the three, but we try to separate within this material world. So within the material world, we say, oh, it's the Shiva's dance that creates, which is all correct in one sense. Shiva is creating in one sense, yes, because he is the one who's touching Maya. But original creator, again, is Vino Karano, the Shai Vishnu. So there are a lot, for a general understanding within the universe, you can say, Vishnu is the creator. Why? Because from Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, actually the creation began inside the universe, right? So And Shambhu's expansion are the individual Shivas of the universe who help in the destruction. And that's how he is, he's the destroyer. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what is the function of Sadashiva?
Sadashiva is more like he is Vishnu Tattva in the sense he resides in Vaikuntha. He is more like his associates are actually devotees of Lord Vishnu. Though they worship Sadashiva, they worship him in the mood that he is a devotee. So what happens in Sadashiva Loka, I think, is described in Bhagavatamrita and Harivamsa Purana, that they are having Hari Kirtan and, you know, they are just enjoying the spiritual world, glorifying the pastimes of the Lord.
Mm-hmm. And so Sri Advaita is an incarnation of Mahavishnu and Sadashiva, right?
That's right. So that's why, you know, it is described, that's why Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, he describes about the glance of Mahavishnu, saying that it has two aspects, and one aspect is also called as Advaita, he describes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. He's a. That's why, you know, in many places, you will see even Prabhupada may not make a very clear distinction between Mahavishnu and Sadashiva, because they're very identical. They both appear from Shankarsan. They are very identical in their roles.
Okay, from Shankarsan. Okay. In the second Chaturvyuha, right?
Yes. That's right. Yeah.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Rajeshwari Priyam Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Preeti Vilasini Mataji. Thank you again for a very, very wonderful class. I have a couple questions also. So you were explaining that in the up by Karno, the Kasai Vishnu, we also have prototypes of all the demigods, or mm-hmm. of the demigods. So are they eternal also? I mean, I'm assuming they're eternal, obviously.
Yes.
Are
yes.
they asleep with us during the time?
No.
So they're, because we have some, okay, so they're not. Okay, that makes sense. Because yes. above in Haridham, Vaikuntha, we have some representatives of, there's a Sarasvati and there's yes. a Ganesha here. So are they the ones that you mean that are here?
No, they expand. They again expand. That's what in the seminar that Prabhu said. They appear here. So to
okay, so they're okay. Yeah. So there's yeah. this, there's actually a set in Vaikuntha, Haridham, and then there's a set in this. In
yeah,
this
but they didn't
Brahma.
Show it in the chart because people will get confused. That's what he said.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So that so are they expansions of them, or are they the same people? Our same entities.
Oh, technically, I don't know how to say whether they are expansion or the same. Would it matter?
Okay.
I don't know.
I don't know the technical
words.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Okay, and then about when you said there's some other question I had. Let me think. So the Asiva Loka, I could think kind of question like Rajeshwari Priya Mataji's question. So now those people that are. Just like each devotee has an attraction to a certain form of, you know, maybe Rama or, you know, in Ayodhya or Vaikuntha, you know, Vishnumurti like this. So that those devotees who have an attraction for Lord Shiva, but of course worshipping in the mood of a devotee, so do they go to Sadashiva Loka?
Yes, you're right, yes.
Okay.
That's where they go.
Okay.
Then they have the correct understanding. That's again
okay.
clarified.
Okay.
That's right.
And one other question. Now, this Viraja, the Viraja River, is this, and I'm correct me if I am wrong, is there not also a Viraja River that the living entity passes through after leaving this body?
Yeah, so that, again, so in some places that river is called as Vaitarini. In some
okay.
places,
Vaitarini.
Prabhupada also chooses to call it Viraja. It's okay.
Oh.
Both are correct, but sometimes it's interchangeably used, that word. But this Viraja is not that. So that
okay,
is...
Okay, so it's the Vaitarini. So basically, it's the Vaitarini is the one. Okay, that's the one I remember.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
That's the one I'm
but
more
sometimes,
familiar with.
Even in certain purports, you will see the name as Viraja. But again, he's differentiated it. He's saying that it is not the Viraja of the spiritual... I mean, the thing that divides the spiritual and the material kind. Yeah.
Okay. I think I had another comment, but I don't remember. Anyway, I will ask it if I remember. So thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Paneshwari Lakshmi Mataji. Hare Krishna.
So, Mataji, did you say that Viraja River is not... You know, yeah, as Mataji said, there is a Viraja River that the soul passes to reach the spiritual world. So it is not this, Mataji?
Say that again.
This what Paneshwari Mataji said, you know, the soul,
mm-hmm.
and the soul is leaving the material world and going to the
soul. Oh, yeah, see,
So this is not that river, Mataji?
Yeah, wait. I want to clearly differentiate. The thing is, when the soul devotee, when he's going to the spiritual world, he crosses the Viraja River. That is this river only, okay? But in the hellish planets, when the soul is taken to the hellish planets to get punishment, at that time also he crosses one river within the material universe. So sometimes that river is called as Vaitarini. That is a different river, okay? But the river that you cross to go to Vaikuntha or Goloka is actually this Viraja that we have been talking about the entire class. I hope I clarified that correctly.
Which is also the causal ocean.
Yes.
Yes,
okay.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. And also, Mataji, Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, you said he is on the water bed, right? So is it that that same ocean bed that we have in our universe? Like the ocean, you know, 3/4 is ocean or how much ever is the ocean here? 1/3?
The salty ocean, the different oceans of this Earth?
Yeah, the water
no.
body that we have on Earth, you know, all
no,
the oceans.
No.
Big water body, no?
No. So that we will, when we do the material universe, when we, especially if you all want to listen, we can do the Bhumandala in detail.
Again, Bhumandala itself will take a couple of classes, but if you want to do, we can try. We can try. I mean, we can learn and try. So this Bhumandala, you see the stalk that is coming out from Vishnu's navel, and you see 14 lokas, and there you see the seventh loka, which is called as Bhur. So it says the abode of human beings and other mortals. That is where, in that Bhumandala, there is one Bhuloka, and within that Bhuloka, you will see the salty ocean.
Yes, Mataji. Wow, it's 17, I mean 14, and out of that earth is only one. That's right. Okay, Mataji. I was like, maybe that's the one.
Thank you, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Oh boy, this is so happy you're giving this class, because my favorite subject matter is this. Anyway, I have so many questions, but mostly just to clarify some things. I don't know where to start. Okay, how about this? Lord Brahma's birth, right, of our universe, mm-hmm. or of any universe, mm-hmm. he is basically an expansion of the prototype Brahma, right? Mm-hmm. All of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so when we hear in the Bhagavatam about the birth of Lord Brahma coming mm-hmm. from the navel of mm-hmm. Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, mm-hmm. so his birth in Garbhodakshaya Vishnu's navel is actually an expansion of that prototype that comes from Mahavishnu's right limb.
Mm-hmm.
So
basically what happens is there are the prototypes of demigods there in the there around Karnodakshaya Vishnu. That Brahma is actually different. Yes, this Brahma who's coming out from the navel is supposed to be an expansion in one sense, but they are different. Like, for example, the Brahma that is there as the prototype is actually called as Hiranyagarbha Brahma, and he's the principal, seminal principle of all the Brahmas in every universe.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the seminal principle of the Brahmas of every universe. So that's how we understand. He's not exactly the same, because here it is a Jivatma that is coming out from the navel. Okay?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so I understand that they're not the same entity. So they're not really expansions in the normal.
Really, yeah.
So yeah. I guess what I don't understand is what the actual relationship is. That, you know, what the actual connection is between the prototype Brahma and, the Brahmas of the various universes, you know?
What is the connection? It's just a prototype form and prototype function that they have
Mataji, I'm just thinking. I'm thinking, could it not be like an ambassador representative? So basically,
yeah.
it's the post. So it's
yes.
the post of the Brahma that's in each universe. That's a post, right? So basically,
yes.
that prototype Brahma, the original Brahma, has given his. I don't want to say stat, his, you know, his position.
Yes.
You know, I don't want to say that. I don't say
I think you want to say appointment, like he appoints. Maybe.
Right.
Yes.
So he said, here,
yes.
you're my representative, my proxy or something like that. You're my representative. You know, my
mm-hmm.
proxy, here, okay, you represent me. Just like in the colonies,
mm-hmm.
you know, they had the representative of, we have a representative,
mm-hmm.
right? And
he,
although he's not the actual king or actual president, he's got the powers of the president right there, because the king has given him the certificate and said, hey, you're the boss in this country or in this place. So that's what I'm thinking. That's what it is. So,
yes,
so that's why
correct.
The...
That's correct. I think this is
yes.
how Tamal Krishna Maharaj explained it. I mean, like in his Brahma Samhita here. Yeah.
Okay, so it's like he's got... the powers, and that way each Brahma can change. Right, and each and that way a living entity can actually take that post. It's not the same one every time. That kind of clarifies, that kind of answers that position.
Yeah. Yeah. I think proxy is a good word, like you were saying.
Proxy is not. Yeah. You're right.
Okay, also, I just want to, you know, somebody, I too had a question about Advaita Acharya.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I too have understood that he is, let's say, a combination of Sadashiva and Mahavishnu.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't, maybe this is beyond the scope of this class, but I was just wondering, you know, again, to get a better idea of what that means or why they came together. If it's too much for this class, it's okay. You know, we can talk about it differently.
So the question is why?
Yeah, the question is, I don't know, I guess, I was going to ask, you know, what does that really mean that they're a combination of the two, but also why the two combined? What was that purpose? Well, you know, in other words, the story, what's that about? What's the story behind their having come together as one entity? Like I said, it might be too much for this class.
Yeah, I have no idea why they are often connected or often kept together or often used interchangeably. But they have just a slightly different function. One is just like a devotee, in the mood of a devotee, that is Sadashiva. And Mahavishnu is not exactly in the mood of devotee, rather he is doing the creation. So there is a dual function that's happening with them. So you see the differentiation there because of the functions that they are performing. So similarly, Advaita Acharya is also, you know, you can understand that he is also in the mood of a devotee, but still Advaita Acharya is also not Jiva Tattva in that sense, or rather, he's like Vishnu Tattva, right? He is Vishnu.
Yeah, he's Vishnu. Yeah. You said that, one thing I didn't quite get, you said that when Mahavishnu casts his glance, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I think that's when you said there's two aspects of the glance, right?
Yeah, and the glance itself is termed like that. The glance is termed in two names, two aspects. Part of the glance actually gives the pradhan, the other part actually excites it to creation.
Uh-huh.
It excites the whole thing. And that excitement part, the glance portion that excites the pradhan, is called as Advaita Acharya, according to Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami. He just told us that name. Yeah.
Okay, so the aspect that excites the pradhan is Advaita.
Yeah.
And the one
the aspect that transforms to Shambhu, remember? So, again, that Shambhu is coming from Sadashiva, so there you can see a connection.
And we said that Lord Shiva is it the halo of the glance, or
the halo of the glance? Yes.
So it's not the glance itself, but the effulgence created by the glance.
Yeah.
And
that's
then...
Go ahead. Yeah, that's why the glance is called as Mahavishnu, right? The glance itself is called as Mahavishnu. And the dim halo becomes Advaita Acharya, who is actually, the dim halo transforms into Shambhu. It's a transformation. So... yeah, they try to give some variations in the glance itself, like different aspects of the glance.
Okay, and I think I've understood too that the Lord Shiva, when he excites the pradhan.
Mm-hmm.
That is when the primordial soup becomes differentiated.
Yes.
And that,
it begins to unravel. Yeah.
And then that differentiation, I think this is going to be the next class, but that differentiation is called mahat tattva.
Yeah.
The differentiated aspect.
Yes.
Okay. Also, one thing I was trying to resolve, you know, we say that Mahavishnu does not come in contact with his material energy, yet the material universes emanate from his pores. So in that sense, it does seem to be contact, so I couldn't resolve that.
Mm-hmm. So the material universes, it's more like it is just a seed, you know, like the seed of the material universes. So rather, everything ultimately comes from the Lord. Okay, everything
mm-hmm.
ultimately comes from the Lord. But only when it is excited, or only when the pradhan transforms the kala into mahat tattva, I mean, when the kala factor comes, actually, the contamination begins. You can think like that.
No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Preeti. There's a word you use. I didn't understand it probably. I think you said, did you say kala?
Yeah, kala, a time factor.
Okay, so
the time,
can you just repeat?
Yeah.
Can you just repeat, because I lost it. Okay.
So the time factor is actually, so before the excitement, see, after the excitement, think like this, after the excitement or after the role of Maya Devi waking up, till she, only after she wakes up, actually these golden spheres that are seen in the pure form or golden seeds are actually becoming the material universes, right? So till then, it is somewhat in a spiritual state. You can think of it like that.
Mm-hmm.
The golden sperms that are coming out. These are all in sperm forms, you know, like not fully developed like that. They are coming out. The seeds are coming out.
So let's say up until the time that the Shambhu contacts Maya Devi.
Maya, yes.
Up until that time, we can say that the universes are in like a golden spiritual seed form.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
It was just, I think there was just one more thing. Garbhadak Ocean, do we... Is it said what that ocean, that substance is made of?
Yeah.
It's what?
Aspect of Garbhodakshay Vishnu.
No, I'm sorry. I guess our connection is not that good. You said that substance is what?
The sweat of Garbhodakshay Vishnu.
Yeah. So, yeah, but that's what I'm asking, that sweat. You know, because we hear about the different types of oceans, you know. Maybe that's Blue Mandala. I don't know. I might be getting it confused. But
yeah,
you hear about
milk
ocean. Okay. So
yes.
So when it comes to the sweat of Garbhodakshay Vishnu, you know, it doesn't describe it any further than that. It's just...
No. It is supposed to be very spiritual in nature. So there's no description with respect to the, you know, like how it tastes or feels. No. As far as I know, I've not seen. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Maybe there is. I don't know.
But, you know, one thing, though, is that, you know, when, wasn't it Lord Varaha who rescued the earth from the Garbhadak Ocean?
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
So when I heard that story, I think they were saying that he took that boar form, you know, because he, you know, the earth was rescued from, like, you know, like a nasty substance, you know, and that's what boars do. You know, but since Garbhadak Ocean is spiritual, I'm wondering why it was characterized as like that, you know, in that negative
Yeah, that's a good question you have.
Mm.
So that is something
I heard, I mean, I don't know the exact reference, so I'm not able to say it pinpointedly. But I had heard it's like, you know, like a viscous, nasty thing, like viscous, you know, like that. And it was also
is from Gobindakshay Vishnu, you know, so. Yeah.
Yeah, I can find out. I can read or find out and see. Or if anyone else has any inputs on this, they can also share. That's a good question, though.
Anyway, I want to thank you so much for going into this subject matter in such detail. I really appreciate it so much. I'm so happy you're the one doing it, giving it. Thank you very much, Mahavi.
Thank you so much, Gaurangi Mataji. Yeah. Thank you for your beautiful questions and very nice insight. Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Okay.
We can check on this as well. If someone has any input, please share. Otherwise, we can check on this, the Ganga Ocean, more in detail. Anyone else has any questions or comments? Or corrections, additions? Okay. So we can end the call. Thank you all so much for joining and giving us your very valuable association. Vancha Kalpata Rubhyascha, Kripa Sindhu Bhyayavacha, Patitanam Pavanebhyo, Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Ananta Koti Vaishnav Vrinda Ki Jai, Shri Prabhupada Ki Jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Priti Vilasini Gopi, Dandavat Pranam, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Srila Gurudev Ki Jai. Such a wonderful class. Maybe you preparing from last 2 months, Mataji. Koti Koti Dandavat Pranam to your Seva. Can you please explain again the 4 lines you explain us that Lord Shiva, Parvati Maya, and Brahmaji, and connected with the electric something, and that is very nice. Can you please explain again, Mataji?
Sure. Thank you so much, Mataji. Thank you for being there on the call today. So the question is about the 4 people that we see in the Viraja area. I'll go back to our slide. Oh, yeah. So now we have the 4 people who are 4 manifestations. One is the Karano Dakshay Vishnu, then you have Rama Devi, then you have Shambhu, and then you have Maya. So what's happening between the 4 of them? So you see Mahavishnu is glancing at Rama Devi. They are enjoying pastimes. That glance forms a dim halo. You can see that it is dimmed out, the light, and that dim halo is Shambhu, and he contacts his consort who is Maya. So the union between Shambhu and Maya, the result is the spiritual, the material world. So that is the result between their contact is the material world. Now, how do we understand the function of the 4 of them? Mahavishnu, he is like the electric powerhouse. So imagine for your city or your town or whatever, where the electric powerhouse is. So that electric powerhouse is Vishnu. The electric energy or the potency that is coming out, the electric energy is actually Rama Devi, because she is the internal potency of the Lord. She is compared to electric energy. And then there is a wire through which this electricity is actually going to run through. That energy is going to run through. It is going to run through a copper wire that actually connects a bulb in our house. So that copper wire is actually Shambhu, because he is the one who is actually going to touch the electrified bulb, the bulb in the house. And that electrified bulb is actually Maya Devi that actually shines. And the material world is created. Okay?
Srila Prabhupada, Srila Gurudev Ki Jai, Dandavat Pranam Mataji. So sincerely you explain and you prepare the lecture. We have to hear 3-4 times, then we understand, Mataji. That one, the forest is done. That one, the forest devotee.
Jai Mataji, that is so true. Actually, it's very difficult to understand. And all glories to our Guru Vargas. Actually, it was Kamal Krishna Maharaj, Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj, and a couple of others who have actually spoken on the subject matter. And of course, the Goloka Chat seminar that is also available. There are many people who have done work on this, so I'm just trying to repeat. And hopefully repeating it all right.
Very much. No, but it is hard, Mataji, to collect from Bhaktisar Maharaj, Bhakti, all the different Makar, Tambakrishna Maharaj, and then you have to prepare the knot, and then you present us, and we are so daffodils that not attentively attend. We have to hear again, then at night time, then we understand the concept, Mataji. That much daffodils devotee.
Thank you so much, Mataji, for encouragement. Okay. So we'll end the call. Thank you all so much for joining. Vancha Kalpataru Vescha Kripa Sindhu Devacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namah Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda Ki Jai Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. All glories to the Assembled Devotees. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.